Oh, can you hear me, Megan? No. Cool. Hi. Hey, how are you?
Sorry about that. I had like YouTube videos going on in the background because I was downstairs with my fiance watching football, and I was like, oh, wait, there's so much going on. So, hi, I'm Megan.
Hi, Megan. I'm Lynette.
It's nice to meet you and see you.
Yeah, same here. It's, I'm always nervous that no one's going to show up, so.
Well, isn't that always, I always feel that way. I feel like I'm even nervous just, like, being on a Hangout. I'm like, whew, I get all, like, excited. I just published an ebook with about 11 other women from across the country, and it was called Whimsy for Wendy's, and we did a 12-hour Google Plus dance party.
Oh, wow.
And it was super-duper intense, but we were like, will anybody show up? And, you know, after, like, putting it out there, eventually some nice people showed up and some strange people showed up. So it was really interesting.
Yeah, I'm always nervous to do public, like, yeah. Where everybody can come in.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I had a couple strange experiences in the beginning with that. So now I'll do extended circles, which is what I did now, which is kind of how I could get most people in, but I don't always do public because, yeah, some of the really strange people come. So yeah. I'll have to look up the ebook that you put out.
Yeah, I'll make sure I send you a link. It's pretty cool. It's all about how to stay whimsy in your everyday life. So this idea that after Wendy from Peter Pan grew up, she lost this connection to her younger self. This idea that you can do anything you imagine.
That is awesome.
Different articles on how to integrate those things back into your life. And since I'm a memory keeper, I did a whole tutorial on how to make a whimsy playbook, so where you can document some of your whimsiest moments to then reflect on when you're feeling, you know, a little disconnected or something.
That is, yeah, I definitely have to check that one out.
Yeah,
definitely.
It's really cool.
Hello, Stacy. She's down. I don't know if she's got sound yet. I don't see earbuds in.
I know. I'm going to go grab mine really quick. I'll be right back.
Okay.
Hi, Lynette.
Hello.
How are you?
Good. You're frozen a little
for
me.
I'm shaking. I'm having the same problem I think I had last time with you. I'm jittery. I'm frozen on yours?
Yeah, a little bit.
Shit. I don't know how to fix this. It's been going on for a while with the webcam. It's that jumpy thing that happens.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Max headroom.
Yeah, is that what it is?
You remember that?
Yeah, I do remember that. Did you have a good holiday?
Yes, I did.
Good. Okay.
I had to go back to the grocery store today because I got to eat out of the house and home, so.
Did family over?
Yeah, not much. Not like when I was little. You know, I grew up in a big Polish household, so we used to have like 50 people in the house. So it was small this time, which is fine. I just didn't plan ahead enough.
That's all right. That makes you know, that's part of the fun.
Yeah. And my brother's coming over, not tonight, I think he's going to be over tomorrow, 25 and eats like a horse, so.
Okay.
It's small meals all day long, so.
That's great.
That's about that. Well, thank you both very much for joining me. You know, coming in that you had to click the okay to the EULA or whatever, that this is streamed. So what happens with this is it's actually live on my, not on YouTube. YouTube, it gets recorded as we go along, and then it's live a little while after. Depends how long the session's for. If it's short, it goes up quick. If it's long, it takes longer to, you know, transcode, do all that stuff. But right now, people will be able to go to my stream, and there'll be a public viewing for this, like a little YouTube video, and they could click on it and watch it from the outside, which is kind of cool.
That's so cool.
And you can take that and share it because it's in my stream. But if you share it, people will be able to find their way back sort of thing and watch it if they wanted to. So
cool.
That's what that is. I get to play around with it because I think rumor has it, nobody really says for sure, but about 200 people have this ability right now. So I was super psyched to get a hold of it. So I figured, well, if I'm going to have this on-air ability, I should do something useful for the planet, right? I don't know how useful for the planet this is going to be, but my goal for today, since I always set New Year's resolutions in March.
Yes.
Yeah, I did. Well, like, because then I don't want to look like I'm jumping on the bandwagon with anybody else. I kind of, like, hang back cool for a little while. And then about March, I'm like, yeah, I'm probably ready. But this year, I really have to. Last year, I did. I on a personal and a professional level, I came around about March. But this year, I figured since I was so late last year, I'll have to do something early. So part of what I do with clients is, not help them walk through goals, either for social media or more. I've been dealing with professional women in whatever capacity professional means for them, and helping them kind of work through this. So I thought it'd be kind of a cool exercise if we kind of set some goals or talked about things that we wanted to set goals for ourselves in the past, maybe why it didn't work and how we could kind of get around that and do better this time. So do either of you ladies want to throw your hat in the ring first? Or is it going to be me?
No, I'm working on getting more clients. I'd like to see how I can help people. I found out I'm really good with, editing and podcasting, and I just like to develop that. So I'm kind of sort of stalled in that, That's my goal. I don't know if I'm having problems or what, but that's my goal. That's the agenda for 2012.
See, me as an old project manager, I was a best practices project manager. And it's something that I learned in that discipline, and it's managers or project managers all over the place, is a concept called SMART or smarter. Have either of you heard of that?
Spelled SMARTR.
Oh, well, I use an E, actually. I need my own.
Okay, no, then I don't know it.
But I don't want to say I don't follow it 100% myself, but because when I say I want to do something, that's exactly what I do. I say this is my end goal. Like, this is what I want. I want to be this, kind of when I change my careers and when I reinvent myself. Which I just did the transformation for me kind of last year. I it took me a long time to get in the cocoon, figure out what I wanted to do, and come back out on the other side. My joke is that I want to change my profession within my own business every 7 years. I get that itch. I said, better my job than my husband, so it's all right. He's happy about that. But smarter is specific, so you have to have something specific. So, like you were saying, I want to you want to get into this, the editing. No, I know you, the audio editing side of things is what you like, right?
Actually, even more just the editing, but it seems to make people feel more interested or comfortable. I like the podcasting. I like doing podcasts with people. I think I told you this. I started out podcasting because I wanted to be the voice for interior design podcasting. But I'm finding out that there's all these other people out there that for their businesses, this could be very helpful for them. People who don't want to actually blog, but they're okay with the podcasting. And I love the idea of being able to help them,
Right. So I know that you're transitioning as a career goal is, or business goal. That's what you want to do.
Mm-hmm.
So you're pretty specific on what you want to do. So you've got the S down. The M is measurable, and that's where a lot of us, and in the past six, 7 years that I've been working kind of in a professional capacity in social media, everybody's like, Twitter's not measurable, or this isn't measurable, or whatever. If you don't measure something, you don't know how close to that end goal you come, to that finish line. Like,
sure.
If someone started a marathon and didn't know where the hell the line was at the end, like, where's the ribbon, duh? We need to know where that is or how close we're going to get to that. So thinking about that, what would you say I was going to say, Megan, you want to jump in too. We're kind of all brainstorming here.
Sure.
What do you think would be measurable about something like that, that Stacy wants to get into the idea of doing more podcasts professionally for clients? Maybe pick a number?
Yeah, I would say, since it's kind of, I feel like it's kind of tied to you wanting to get more clients and doing this specific task with them, I'm all about like setting the intention. So setting the intention of, you know, by this date, I want to get X amount of clients that I can work with, you know, and maybe one of those clients is, you know, someone that you'll work with on like an introductory basis. So you kind of like test pilot with them.
And yeah, I did that already.
Okay, cool. So you're there. Like you
now
know what you want to
do. Money at it. Yeah.
Right. So you know what you want to do. So if I was in your position, I would say I want to work with X amount of people by this date. And from that, I want to get some feedback from them. I want to get some testimonials from them and then, you know, build a referral program off of that. So that from those, you know, 3, 4, 5, whatever number feels, you know, right with you, you can then build off of that number. You can continue to, you know, set, you know, marks for yourself and continue to measure your client growth through some type of program like that.
Very clean. Very good. Right, so I'm going to get a piece of paper and write this down since typing is very loud on my computer on this.
Boom, boom,
so
boom.
So it is just like smashing on something.
Can we use the chat there to, as like the whiteboard like we did last time or no?
We could use the chat. The on-air doesn't give you all of those cool extra features like documents and all that, which I would love, but it doesn't. How we see this video with the chat and everything is not necessarily how it gets broadcast or recorded either, but that's okay because we're doing this for us. So
yeah. Well, actually, I was going to say because you used the chat. Then I think I was on a teleseminar, and who was giving it? She didn't know that we were all chatting while she was giving her thing. I said, you know, we can actually download this and then save it as notes.
Yeah.
You know? So that's kind of cool.
Yeah, I copy and paste it.
Yeah.
Yeah, but when I type, my microphone picks it up. Yeah. So let's see, Stacy's goal is to podcast clients, paying podcast clients.
Yeah.
that's the important that word. See, and that's the other thing, that's specific, because you can get all the clients in the world that you want, but if they're not paying, it's not really meeting your goals.
Yeah.
Let's see. Measurable, we kind of said that. My thing I kind of like to do, and you'll see this later on, is I like to have a rolling number. So to say six in a year is fine, but then I always feel like I'm cramming at the end. Mm. So I'll do like one every other month kind of thing. Because that also, as, you know, an independent or, you know, freelance type person where you're not working in a large corporation,
yeah,
where you have team members to kind of distribute the load from, if you brought on 6 clients at one time, you'd be pulling all your hair out. So like for me, I know that if I stagger things, it's also a little bit better. So when I measure things, I kind of do it the trickle effect.
Yeah. Yeah.
So we'll make up numbers for you.
I was actually going, if I could get one new client every month, I think I'd be happy.
Yeah.
You know?
Because that ramp up time with new clients in general is very, regardless of what you do, it's
ongoing.
Stressful.
It's not like one client and you're done. The idea is for it to be ongoing.
Yeah.
Right. I'd be thrilled.
But in the beginning, okay, so we'll say one per month. One new per month.
And, of course, getting that one new client, and I'm sure – I'm sorry, what's your name? I didn't catch
your name. Oh, I'm Megan.
Hi, Megan. I'm sure you can – if you have your own business, you know. So you get that one client, but you're back it up. You've got all this other time into meeting that person and networking for them. Oh, my God, there's so much more work to go into getting that one client, you know. So.
Absolutely.
Yeah, it's feast or famine when you're kind of – when you're independent. And I find myself either heads down in work – or out there kind of feet on the street kind of trying to find. And it gets, it's stressful to have, or income going up and down like that or things like that. That's why I kind of like the even keel of just saying, well, I don't need a ton, I just need one.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And that's why you I think it helps if you're networking, you get into good, solid referral groups. You help them, but they have your back too. Mm-hmm. So that it should, if they're good, that should minimize how much work you actually have to do. You know, it's not like starting fresh and cold every single time.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's the idea anyway.
All right, and that actually brings us to the A, which is attainable. Okay. You know, for me to go out and say, I want 5 clients every month that pay me $10,000 would be absolutely crazy. Like, that's just not going to happen. $10,000 a month. That's not going to happen. So as long as it's attainable, I think is, and you know, and the other thing that did my E that goes in there that I added sometime in my early 30s, I think I might have added it,
To smart? You added an E to smart?
I made it smarter.
Oh.
Smarter. Smarte at the end. No, I put ER at the end because I wanted to be different. I think I've seen it other places that way, too.
I know what you're talking about now. Now that you're saying this, I get what you're doing. Yeah, I've heard it.
But so attainable. Relevant is also the other thing because, let's see, 2010, I was spinning my wheels on something that I realized I didn't want to do anymore, which was kind of chase those big, big clients, like the Fortune 500 things. I realized that, yeah, when I get them, then I have to go there and I have to wear pantyhose and heels and hide the purple in my hair, and that really was not relevant to me, so that's kind of how I interpreted that. But this for you, I know, Stacey, is relevant because this is your kind of – this is what you've evolved into that you've
actually. What's really funny that I hear you say that. This is a side thing. This is like the second career. I haven't stopped being an interior designer, but I've been struggling with clients in that area too, because I've been adjusting. And you say that, and I just had the opportunity recently to get a bigger client, which those have been so hard to get, and that's where I really shine. And it sort of reminded me because it's been so long. I really want those. I'm going to start revamping my interior design part of my life back up to that because that's really where I shine. This whole podcasting was supposed to be that I could do this on the side. Mm-hmm. This is not something that can, you know, and if, listen, God, it should only be that it takes off, right? This should be the worst problem I have. But, you know, I didn't expect it to be this all-encompassing, you know, 9-to-5, 24/7, but if it did, it did. I didn't know. And I was thinking this was a great second career, you know. So, anyway, sorry.
Well, that's also an idea, too, as far as measurable goes, or just give yourself a time limit with it. Say if it doesn't work or be where you want it to be in however, you know, in a year, in 6 months or whatever, to cut it back and just think of it more as a hobby rather than a second income or a second line for you. Because that, I think, takes some of the stress away. Years ago when, you know, podcasting started and a lot of people wanted to kind of quit their day jobs and do this, they didn't realize how much hustle it took to actually do.
Exactly.
Because when it was a hobby and it was fun, it was one thing, but when they had to produce day after day after day and get numbers and subscribers, and then when it became a job, they didn't like it. But it, you know, it's more evened out. So, you know, if for anybody watching, that, you know, everybody wants to do what they love for a living. But sometimes when you do it, you realize, you know what, this really kind of sucks. You don't want to do it for a living. You just want to do it for fun.
And that's true of interior design. I mean, I'm putting together this workshop for interior design. It's going to be for the spring. And I'm doing it because I've had enough people say to me, oh, yeah, this is not – I mean, I'm good at this. I have good taste. Whatever. It's a lot different than you think it is to be an interior designer as a profession. There's a process. And to really do this correctly, it's hard. I'm not saying it's not doable, but it goes beyond just doing your own home and a hobby. Same thing as podcasting. Or any of what we do. There's a quality to what you put out, and you have to have integrity for that. If you don't want to keep improving and learning and educating yourself in the newest things or you know, information about your industry, then it is a hobby, or you're not very good. You know,
but one or the other.
We're not very good. But, I mean, that's why I got into the podcasting, because I started to do it for my own marketing purposes, not to do it as a profession. But I found that I was actually really good at it. People liked talking with me, and I loved doing the editing. Well, that's some of the stuff that people actually don't like doing, you know, in podcasting. That I found that out. So I said, well, this is a great alternative, you know, or second thing. Anyway.
Yeah, well, that actually makes it relevant for you and for them, because if you're feeding a pain point, you know, servicing a pain point for them, because to want to do the thing everybody else wants to do also is very difficult.
Sure.
So, yes, I mean, this happened to coincide for, you know, you're taking on this project that you want to turn into something that actually coincides with your profession. The T is time bound. These stand for a lot of different things. These are just my interpretations of it. Mm-hmm. I've been kind of, I don't want to say walking the walk with this because I stray away from it quite often. But time bound, the whole idea of you have to be able to measure it in some sort of quantity, and usually some sort of a time issue. Like, if I want to get 5 new clients, that's awesome. But if it takes me 5 years to do it, that's so good.
Yeah.
But that's my idea of making sure that you kind of I roll it out, because it's a little too difficult for me to do all or nothing. Same, you know, even personal goals, weight loss. You know, I'm not going to go a whole year. I want to lose 50 pounds. I can't go a whole year and not do anything, and then the last, you know, month I'm cramming. I'm like starving myself, running myself to death. You can't do that.
It doesn't work that way. Shit, that's why it's working.
Still break the dream.
It doesn't work that way. So if you could think about, like we said, one per month. So that's sort of the time band. Now, some things I do are they roll forever, and some things I go, okay, at the end of 6 months, it doesn't work. It's not going to work.
Yeah.
I gave myself a year from, well, it's actually March to March, but for me, for some of the goals that I had set for myself. But I've already gotten there, so I'm okay.
Cool.
Woo.
And the E is actually evolves for me, for smarter, because you need to, I think my... When I was kind of trained in all of this 20 years ago, when I started doing what I was doing back then, everything was set in stone. It was not movable. It was you had something, or it was, you know, considered scope creep. Like, don't ask for anything else. Don't shift anything. This is the way we wrote it up day one. It's never going to change. But I don't think that that's, especially as a professional, that we have to be the pilots of how we're going to kind of run our ship.
You always have to be willing to evolve.
If you get halfway through this and you go, I can't do this, it's totally not what I want to do, you need to be able to, for yourself, you know, say, let's reassess this, let's take a look, I don't want to do this. Or if it evolves into something else,
that's exactly what happened.
I have to be doing what I'm doing now, for sure. I was like, oh, let's make some friends, you know, kind of thing. But you have to be able to evolve with it. And mentally, that's a huge step for, I think, a lot of women, because it's the same thing. If you set out to do something and you don't do it, then that means you fail. No, that means you just want to do something different now. And I know professionally it's hard for me to swallow that. So I'm not sure what both of your views are, but as long as you could make it pliable and kind of go around, the E is the most important one for me. Because it does change. And then the R is reassess. And that's always, I give myself hard kind of deadlines to sit and purposefully take the time to look at stuff to see if I want to, if I'm on track, if I care anymore, what I need to do, that sort of thing. So those were my kind of ideas to get started with setting goals.
I love it. I'm like sitting here, I'm like, oh, man, there's so much great stuff happening right now. I'm like, this is awesome.
Hello, Kimberly. Kimberly's on her way in. I never know how long it takes people to actually to come in. So, Megan, like, do you have any goals off the top of your head that you could think of you would want to, like, work on?
I have so many goals. Oh, my gosh. I have to, like, you know, limit my goals because they're just so overwhelming. So I have 3.5 jobs. One's a full-time job. 2 are entrepreneurial pursuits. So I work for a radio station full-time. 40
Which
hours
one?
A week. It's a rock radio station in Philadelphia, WMMR. And so I work there full time. And then on the side, I run a scrapbooking, memory keeping business. And then I also do social media management for a small, I have like 1.5 clients right now because I had to scale back because my biggest thing was I had no time. You know, I wasn't sleeping. I wasn't servicing people the way that they deserve to be serviced. So I'm in a process right now where I'm scaling back to scale up. So I'm rolling things backwards so that I can choose the things, you know, become more specific, and find out where my passion really lies. And what I'm finding is that my passion really lies in being self-employed. So finding a way to, like, do things that, you know, energize me and make me get excited and passionate while simultaneously not sitting at a desk for 40 hours a week, you know, or, like, sitting... And a desk could be like just a cubicle. Like, I'm not made for a cubicle. So there's so many different things that get me excited. And number one is working with people to help them grow their business. And number two is memory keeping. Two thoroughly unrelated things. But in the way in my brain is that I can bring them together, kind of like you, Stacey, where one is kind of generating revenue. It's what I know I'm really good at, and the other one is kind of generating a little bit of other revenue, and I know that I'm really good
multiple
at
streams of income. It's the new
yeah.
it's the new 9 to 5.
There's, yeah, totally.
Yeah, totally.
So my goal is to really scale in on my or zone in on my vision, right? To say I'm doing this scrapbooking business. Much like you, I want to get some more dedicated, committed clients. I want to build out my workshop so that I can offer them digitally, so not just to people in my home or in their home, so that I can really expand my client base in that regard. And then, you know, in the social sphere, is really not stop, but move away from the management. I've been doing social media management and more into a consulting role. So to help people design their social media identities and learn how to use the social web as opposed to just pay somebody else to do it for them. Because I really feel that there's a certain level of empowerment that comes with understanding the tools and how they're going to help you, you know, generate more revenue by growing your business.
I totally agree with you on that. Totally.
So, I mean, in both of those things, like, I'm all about empowering people to learn a task. I'm big on teaching. So just finding a way to help me, you know, get more money so that I can transition out of my full-time job. Not that I don't love working at the radio station. I've been there.
What do you do at the radio station?
Well, I'm a voiceover talent. I work as a sales assistant. I've done everything there. I've worked in the mailroom. I've been the receptionist.
It's a great atmosphere, I bet, huh?
Yeah, it's very high energy.
Yeah, that's what I meant.
You know, constantly changing, nothing ever stays the same. So it's a good environment for me to be in. If I had to be in an office environment, that would be the place that I need to be. But, you know, I think with any job like that, you meet your end, sort of. You know, like, you can only be an administrative assistant for so long if you have a certain amount of, like,
ambition,
passion. That's like,
yeah.
Yeah, and I'm an artist. Like, I'm a creative person.
Yeah.
So, like, sticking me in front of a Microsoft Excel for 8 hours is
not a good idea.
No, it's smothering, and I just, like, lose myself. So
You burn out your feelings of creativity so much faster.
Oh, totally. So I write poetry at my desk, and I keep, like, inspirational quotes from, like, Danielle Laporte. I mean, it's just crazy what I do at my desk. I stand up on my desk and, like, freak out sometimes. And we really say that we should have, like, a reality TV show in our office, because it's just like frisbee flying across the room.
You're blowing a perfect opportunity. Starting a podcast right there about things that go on at the radio station.
I know. Maybe we can hook up about that.
Maybe
we can help you on your client list. So there's a lot going. Plus, I'm getting married next year. I'm getting married next October. So I chose for 2011 to coincide with my goals was this word of ease. So I'm all about releasing and easing. So easing myself to feel like I'm okay with where I'm at, that even if things don't come in the time that I want them to come, they will come, because I'm all about, you know, intention and putting yourself in a place that, you know, if you keep working toward it, if you do even one small thing each day, you can get to that that place that you really feel that you're supposed to be in. So releasing my attachment to the end result, letting things show up as they want to show up, and easing, being okay with how everything goes and going with the flow. And it's so much easier saying it than I feel like it will be.
How are you doing this? Can you give some tips on that? I'm sorry, Lou.
for the ease, for me, it's all about just, like, staying centered around that word, like, coming back to it, like, putting reminders up. Like, I put things in my Google Calendar that's like, how are you doing with this? Like, how are you fostering your intention of ease?
That's a great idea.
I joined a gym. I send out daily prompts. Right now I'm doing a reverb project, so that's kind of helped me build up this thing of, like, you know, rituals.
Mm-hmm.
So, and then I'm simplifying. So I'm getting rid of clothes, and I'm getting rid of empty boxes and throwing away paper, things that are so outside of my comfort zone, but I feel this release in them. So release is, to me, directly related to ease, because ease is inside of release. I don't know if that means anything, but to me, like,
it's very profound.
You know,
it is.
It just, I'm all about letting go, and letting go of baggage, letting go of emotional stuff, and I feel like that's opening me up to the possibilities, you know, like, inviting great women into my life, letting me join these circles and become a member of better tribes that just nurture my creativity, and I'm just really grateful. So my new year is about love, gratitude, and ease, and those are my goals.
So those are your goals, exactly.
Yeah. Yeah, so.
Those are, you know, it's funny because and it's one of the things that I'm striving to try to do myself. I come from such an analytical profession, and to get back into, and that's the one thing that I was missing, I think, last year, and when I was kind of switching what I was doing, is all of these things that you were just talking about, more like my goal should be a state of mind or a state of being of how I feel, and how things that I do, what the result of that, how that makes me feel, what the outcome is, rather than just being able to check it off of a list.
Right. Why do a to-done list now? So my friend, her name's Coach Jenny, and she recommended to me that instead of making to-do lists, I make to-done lists. And to-done is as soon as I finish something, I put it on this list, and at the end of the day, I look at it, and I'm like, wow, I accomplished so much. I did 6 loads of laundry. I went to the bank. I cooked dinner. I fed myself. I took a shower.
Wow.
And then I did 6 scrapbooking pages. And it invigorated me. I was like, all these little things that I do that I take care of myself, but then also contribute to my, you know, goals of growing my business. I'm doing all of this simultaneously. And I think it's very atypical of women to just feel overwhelmed by all the stuff that needs to get done,
yeah,
as opposed to looking at the things that we've done, which sometimes is just, wow, we are superheroes, you know, it's rather amazing.
You're the one that's responsible for getting them done. It's
Yeah. You
know, overwhelming, and we women, that's what we do, because we're ultimately, obviously you don't have kids, right?
Not yet.
But I do, and actually they're in college, but the fact is it's that mindset, so you always have to, you know, you're dealing with other human beings, plus yourself, plus your business. It does, it gets overwhelming, and I don't know.
To done. That's what you need.
Yeah, it's much better because it's disheartening to look at the list when every, you know, because if you make a to-do list, and this is actually something in my notes that I wanted to talk about today. Mm. I like to make lists because I like the satisfaction of checking things off of my list.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, me
and
too.
I usually run lists. It's just like a notepad thing that I just, you know, empty document that I have on my desktop all the time. I don't write down what can I do in 15 minutes, but has anybody ever heard of the Fly Lady? Mm-hmm. She's organizational. I think it's the flylady.net or something like that, and I forget what FLY stands for something, but she's been around like pre-internet. And the idea of this is to be able to like tidy your home and your space that you live in or your work environment or whatever, to kind of keep a cluttered environment, cluttered mind kind of thing. And she has this thing where you can walk around and do the 15-minute fling, I think it's called. Like, what can you accomplish in 15 minutes? Type thing.
Yeah.
Where she's usually about more like, I would have to say, home ec type things. But I usually do it for work.
Yep.
What can I do in 15 minutes? I could blow through my email. I could do this. I could do that. I don't know, write those down. But what can I do by the end of today, the end of the week, and the different dates and times and things like that. But then I write it down, and what happens is those are my goals for me of things that I need to get done in by a specific date or for a particular purpose that's my purpose. But clients and kids and spouses and everything else encroaches in on that. But the to-done list covers that because – I fed my kids today. I did whatever, like, you know, those kind of things, because those are not things that we generally consider a task. They're just something that we did.
I put them on.
It eats at your time.
If they take up the time, that's it. If it's just something that I have to give some time to, more than just, you know, you wake up, you know, automatically the first things you do is go to the bathroom, brush your teeth, wash your face, get, you know, do your toiletry habits. That's sort of, you don't even have to think about that. But anything else after that is something that's unusual. You know, now my daughter's home for the month, you know, from college. So now my behavior, I guess, is adjusting. And it'll go back to when she was gone. But the point is, I actually have to have food ready now.
Yeah.
I wasn't doing that when she was gone. This was great. I forgot what it was. I didn't have to worry about meals. But I used to do that. I used to have to say, make sure you, I mean, there are times where you forget to buy food. Or didn't have time.
That's me today.
I know, you're crazy, but it's crazy. Yeah. I don't have to worry about that stuff on a regular basis now that they're gone. But
yeah. Do you find sometimes, so I do both. So I do, on Sundays, I sit down and I do an entire to-do list on a legal pad. And it has like 6 quadrants. So it has,
I'm totally more organized than we are.
I just use the
Google task. And then I check it off. That way it's in my phone.
See, I'm a writer. I got to write it down on paper, or it's just like, I have a whole notes thing on my Mac thing over here for like one of my clients, and I'm looking at it, and I'm like, what? I had to do that, you know? But I do, like, if I do the quadrants, I'll do one for, you know, this client, one for my other client, one for my biz, one for my workshops, one for my personal life, and then, you know, little reminders about my full-time job, you know, or life events that I have going on. Like, mm-hmm. I have to remind myself to go to the gym. Wonder why. It's no fun.
Do you? So you don't have different notebooks for different things?
No, because I've tried it, and I just cannot compartmentalize my life like that. Just like I can. See, my fiance and I work together. So we met at the station. We work at the station. There is no, you know, like, black line of this is this job, this is that job. You know, like, I take my computer into work, and on my lunch breaks, I'm going and working part-time, you know. So I do a lot of blending. And I've had this conversation with a lot of people lately about how they work. Like, what is their pattern of getting through their day?
The organization methods, yeah.
Right. And some people, Lynette, maybe you posted something about this the other day, you know, asking people about how they compartmentalize their work, or, you know.
Nope, that wasn't me.
Okay, well, so it was somebody else.
I would have totally said it was you, Lynette. You should have taken credit for it.
Just run with it. Right, but it was something about, like, can you separate your work life from your personal life? And my immediate gut answer for me was like, no, I can't. You know,
entrepreneurs don't tend to be able to do that. I'm sorry. And I know all the big coaches say, you should. Sorry.
No.
Not happening. You can't.
I mean, I don't even think I want to, because I find that my business is such a part of who I am, and a lot of the leads that I get for my business, for my workshops, are because I have brought my business into my personal life, and I'm all about selling through passion. Like, I don't have to sell something if I totally believe it and I'm passionate about it. Mm-hmm. And, you know, not blurring, you know, if I was just like, okay, I'm
Because we probably don't have the luxury of having this receptionist that can take care of all the stuff for us. So we always do have to be on. And, you know, I get things come through me Sunday night at 10 o'clock at night. Yeah. It'll happen, you know. And I'm not going to say, sorry, I'm not working, you know.
Yeah.
I know people who do that, not me.
Yeah.
Yeah, and that's one of the things that, I was going to say, when I tend to work with people, or even friends that I have, professional and personal friends, I guess, at this point.
Right.
It's the same thing. I found one of the things I had to do last year was decide that I wasn't going to take certain types of clients. Mm-hmm. You know, I wasn't going to take it because I thought it fit into whatever I was supposed to be doing.
Mm-hmm.
Like, Megan, it sounds like that's what you're kind of trying to streamline what you want to take on at this
point. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. It's all about,
clarity.
Like, being...
clarity.
Yeah, and being okay with saying no. I think it was... I can't remember the exact blogger's name. Lisa Rankin, Dr. Lisa Rankin. She wrote this blog post that my friend had forwarded to me, and it was like, just because you can, and I insert, say yes, doesn't mean you should.
That's my philosophy of life. That's exactly how I live my life.
I say that to my 4-year-old all the time. Just because you can doesn't mean you should.
Right. I use that in how to say no, because I'm really bad at saying no, and I'll take on projects just because, you know, I feel like I feel indebted to someone, or I feel like, you know, it's something that I should be doing, or it's another opportunity, or it could be a missed opportunity. And
or
then
no
all of a sudden, I'm like,
do it as well as I can. Nobody else is going to step up to do it. Yeah. If I don't do it, it's not going to get done at all. Yes.
You know, and what? That works really in design, too, by the way. That work, just because you can. And you know where I came up with the first concept of that is? Emerald, the baker, the cooker, whatever, the chef, he, like, you know how he's his famous saying, bam? He just keeps bamming, and it's like, just stop to keep bam today. The thing gets piled up, and you're like, oh my God, stop! What did you click? You can't see anymore. But that's the first time I made that connection. I'm like, just because you can do it, like, stop. You should have known that 15 bams ago, it looked really good. Case, you should have left it go. Right?
That's all covered in damn powdered sugar. I can't even see what it is.
But I do. I apply that to design. Just because you can insert something there, or you can, you know, I do. Less is more, that sort of thing. Yeah.
Yeah. And that's a big thing for me is, or that I've, for me personally, but I've also seen a lot with women.
Yeah.
And I got a whole lot of slack early on, flack early on when I started Women of Google Plus. It's like, you know, just to segregate out women, but we do function differently.
We do.
We've been socialized differently. We work. I'm sorry, it's the truth.
And we struggle with the issues a lot more intensely than men.
But what I was going to say, though, too, is we say yes a lot more because we think we have to. And that's, my husband's giving me the look like, oh, I'm going to
say, hold on. He's like, well,
he knows. I know, I think, but if you're ambitious or you're trying to get ahead or you feel like you need to. You need to because you don't want to let that opportunity go or whatever. Or just like, you know, like I would do that with maybe my temple or something. Things that I wanted to do, I could do, but I backed off. I finally backed off because I didn't have the time.
Right.
And that's the thing. The more you say yes to, what does that, we only get 24 hours.
Yeah.
And I realized that everything, especially this past year, having gone through the process myself, everything I wound up saying yes to meant that I had to say no to something that I wanted.
Yeah.
And I really, in the middle of the summer, I became very hostile is not the right word, but like I was like, I was pretty angry at some of the things, and I had already committed to them.
Yeah.
So I followed through with them, but I was totally not happy about it. I was like, this, I understand the repercussions of saying yes too many times.
Yes.
This is hurting goals that I've set for myself, business things I want to do, speaking, whatever I wanted to do, it was eating away from it. Like I had to say no to things that came up that fit my goals and pushed my progress further, what I wanted and I knew was good for me and my family, because I had already said yes to other things that I could no longer. Yes. And that was the thing, you know, I had was told, like, you know, you just forget it, just turn around and say no last minute, and I just couldn't do it. It wasn't in me to do it. Mm-hmm. So I kind of had to grind my teeth and get through it. But now I'm more actively understanding that if I say yes to something, I don't say yes right off. I always, you know, tell me more.
I was just about to insert, say, you know, I ask a lot of questions.
I say yes, and then I don't realize, like,
what's involved?
You wanted me to help with the bake sale. And then I'm like, oh, you wanted me to cook 15,000 cookies? I thought you just wanted me to count the money at the end of the
exactly.
day.
Exactly.
Like, if you don't understand what it is, then you can totally get yourself in a lot of trouble.
Yeah, and there are people who don't ask. There are people who don't ask, so they suddenly find themselves, and that would happen in the early years. I would just jump in, I can do that. And then you find out, wait, you kind of indicated this would be a lot less work, and it's a lot more, you know. So you have to decide whether it's worth going forward or not.
And while I do know people that will bail in the middle, I am not wired that way.
Yeah.
So I know that if I say yes, I have to do it, and it means how much of what I need or what I want is going to be sacrificed because of it.
Yeah.
So there are a lot of things that, you know, even we were talking before about, you know, having goals about X amount of paid clients or X amount of dollars a year or month or whatever, that if sometimes I will do things that don't on the surface look like they're progressing me on a goal, something that I want, because I know that it's maybe the long way around, but it will get me where I want to go.
You know, that's a really good point that you just made. I don't know if anybody else that's on this call, you know, this hangout would agree, because we all have our own businesses. But at some point when you take on, say, a client or a project or whatever it is, there's that, we were talking about before, measurable goals. There's a certain point where you go, you have to be able to look at it and say, this isn't actually bringing me to where I need to be or I wanted it to be, or in my case, you know, as a designer, it's not coming out the way I wanted it to be. Maybe the budget was not what was supposed to happen. Whatever, you know, the measurable goal, the measurable finale. And at some point or another, you're saying you made a commitment and you have a hard time, but what about that other, what was the other one you were saying, the adjusted revisit? What was it?
One of the letters in the smarter.
Yeah.
Reassess.
In other words, that I think that sometimes you have to do that before the end. You have to constantly reassess. You know, when you have big projects, don't you have goal markers that you go to so you make sure you're on task?
But I mean, sometimes you forget how many times you're in the middle of something and you're like, oh my God, please don't ever let me do this again.
Yeah.
Do I say
it so many times?
And then when it comes, okay, sure, I'll do it. Like the, like I have amnesia or something.
Yeah.
That's why people have more than one child. I'm convinced of it. But
that's funny.
I
But you forget sometimes.
Yeah,
that
I
you,
think to battle that, for, not to interrupt, but to battle that, I have somebody. I have found somebody that I check in with, like before I take on a big project. So
Coach Jenny.
sort of like her, or I have a whole tribe of like, you know, female entrepreneurs that I just will go to when I'm stuck on something or I'm feeling resistance and I can't identify what it is. And because they know me so well and know kind of like my habits of taking on projects, will be like, okay, here it is, you know, and they'll just spell it out for me really plainly, like, you just need to say no, or you just need to let this pass, or you're not a failure if you don't do this, you know, and they'll just tell me the things that I need to hear to get me back to that place of like, okay, this is my next step.
You just brought up a really good point, something we haven't discussed. Maybe this would be a really great time, because this is something that is an issue with me. So you want to do this thing, or you feel it's a good thing to do, a job, a project, an event, or whatever. But I feel like when you put it out to too many people, you know, you're going to get all those opinions. So
yeah.
It's not that I hide, but I don't tend to ask so many people because I don't really care what anybody else thinks.
Right.
To a certain degree.
Yeah.
I'm going to do what I want to do. You know,
yeah.
unless it's a really big project, there's a lot of money involved, that I do need some feedback. But, you know, most times people are going to give you their opinion. And so if you're going to someone, and I do have friends that our politics are different, our thinking is different, they're my friend, I would never ask them, you know, I wouldn't ask them for this.
The people that I go to are like, I call them my like-minded tribe.
Okay.
And it's something that I kind of picked up from a Marie Forleo Tuesday video or something, and she was like, you know, have a like-minded tribe. Because
okay.
the idea of having a like-minded tribe is that they get where you're coming from, right?
Okay.
So they're not there to judge you, and they're not there to, like, size you up or, like, say, like, you, not that your friends would discourage you in any way, but, you know, I think with friends it can get personal sometimes, you know, like, we're women and we're kind of, like, competing silently with each other, right, in, like, some way, shape, or form. With your like-minded tribe, it's more of, like, how is this project going to support you? How is it going to facilitate your growth? How is it going to, you know, grow your business, help you get more money, help you, you know, develop your reputation as a designer? All of those, like, really positive pillars of your business, right?
But someone also that doesn't, you know, blow sunshine up your backside.
Right,
exactly.
If they tell
you something, it's going to be truthful, and it's not going to be because you think you need to hear it.
So you need to respect what they have to say. That's the point. So basically, I've been hanging out with the wrong people.
Hang out with us.
We're hanging out. And I think maybe that's an interesting topic, too, because maybe that's where, you know, you do have to kind of, like, separate your business from your personal life a little bit. Because, I mean, my best friend, I love her. She is a sister to me, but I don't really speak my biz to her because, I mean, she's a geology major. She's teaching kids in school. I mean, if I brought to her, like, can you help me reevaluate my business plan? It's just, I feel like it's missing something. She'd be like, but I study rocks. You know? So, I mean, maybe that's where that kind of, like.
And everybody has their own agenda, too. So,
right.
You know, for instance, when I was getting divorced from Mukul years ago, first thing my mother said, God rest her, she's passed on since then, sell the house. What? You know, I have to live somewhere because it was a big nut, and she was afraid I couldn't handle it. I said, well, then what? I have to go somewhere else and pay money to live. What the hell? What is, you know, because that was her fear.
Right,
you know?
Yeah.
Sell the house. No, I don't want to move right now. I just want to figure out how I can deal with these issues going on.
Yeah, so, and I think you touched on a really big word there. Like, for me, sometimes with goal setting, it's like leaning into the fear a little bit.
Yeah.
Right, so it's being like, okay, here are like these things that I'm really flipping afraid of, you know, like the idea of like quitting my job. Oh my God, it's frightening. It's
exactly.
frightening. But finding a way to even in the slightest way lean into that, where it's like, ooh, I'm gonna take a week off from work. Okay, you know, something I've never done before. So just finding those little ways to do it, and finding people to support you in doing that, to like encourage that.
Yeah. You know what's interesting? I don't think, and I watch men a lot and see how they deal with these kinds of business things that go on. I don't think they even can relate to some of this stuff. I don't hear this kind of conversation. Unless they just keep it to themselves, I don't think they process it the same way we do. We take a lot more stuff in. Do you think? Or anybody agree?
I think men are... I mean, once upon a time, I had this friend, and she told me, when you present a man with a problem, he's not going to think it through. He's going to think how he can solve it. Mm-hmm. So they instantaneously are pushed towards, what can I do to fix it, make it better, or, you know, just put an end to it. Whereas we're like, okay, how would this affect the 25 people around me? How would they all feel about it?
Yeah.
Would anybody be offended if I did it this way or that way? And then, you know, at the end of the day, would they like the shirt I'm wearing? You know?
It's just like, I'm not that bad. Some of that's an age.
I am.
When you go,
I totally am.
I'm like, my hair hasn't been cut in 6 months. Oh, my God. And I see this a lot, like, in my own relationships, because I work with a lot of men, and it's like, mm-hmm. I present them with an issue I have, and they're just like, here's a solution. You know, here it is. There you go. Go on your way. Yeah. You know?
Yeah.
Whereas we need to kind of, like, soothe ourselves into, like, making the decision mm-hmm. or, like, getting to that end result.
I don't know. I always look at it as we're just a little bit more sensitive, aware that how it will affect the 25 other people
now.
Because, you know, yeah, I'm kind of like a man that way. I just want the problem. Let's just solve it. Let's move on. But I recognize that you might be affecting 25 other people.
Right.
So
right.
I do take that extra time to consider maybe that's not the only solution. And I always think it's very interesting how men don't look at it that way. You know, men are from Mars, women are from Venus, whatever. I get that, but it's always interesting in business how they approach problem solving and just handling their day-to-day, you know? I don't know. Anyway.
That's why we're all separated now, you know, like everybody cool. I just, you know, and you had mentioned this earlier, Lynette, about like kind of the flack you received with the separation of this group. Like, did you really, I mean, could you talk like just really quickly about like kind of like the resistance you met? You don't have, I mean, if it makes you uncomfortable, like we don't.
Talk about it.
I buried that pain. Come on.
I'm just getting over it.
Well, were you getting flack from men or from men
actually,
and women?
Jennifer knows. Actually, I got, that's because I met Jennifer early on. More so from women, surprisingly. But what it was is my whole goal with this is my quick history is I've been in some way, shape, or form in technology for 22 years, which is awesome considering I'm 26. No, I'm gonna go for that. Okay.
I was putting my surprise face on. I can't believe it.
So I'm used to being what I call the gender minority, put it mildly. You know, me in a department of 40 other guys working in the computer department, that was usually what I was used to. So I never felt it was never like I never had this huge connection to women. I always had a huge connection to people. So I never really saw the difference between men and women. I understand there was a vast difference in how we worked and how we dealt with things in the workplace. Because I've been out of the corporate world for 10 years, 11 years, something like that. I forget how long it's been. But I did the same thing. I kind of did the entrepreneur thing, and then I moved my way into it. But when I came here, and I looked at it, and I said, oh, there should be more women, just because I wanted to have the multifaceted conversations that women have. Men on social media sites generally tend to focus on a couple things, whatever they want to put themselves forward as. Where women that I've seen in my experience in social media sites want to talk about I want to talk about technology, and I also want to talk about makeup. Like, hey, you know, it's all over the place.
Well,
I want to talk about business, and I want to talk about my kids. So it's all over the place. So I was lacking that community, so I decided to create it for myself. And I got a lot of slack saying that I was thrown back to the 50s, that I was segregating women out. I got a lot of that. But my goal for all of this was actually to make the idea of the Women of Google Plus site, if you took the name off, you wouldn't realize it was just for women. It's just people.
Yeah.
We do all the same things guys do. Guys do almost all the same things we do. You know, so that my goal was just to meet other women, and it wasn't to say better, worse, feminist, not, it wasn't any of that business. But unfortunately, because the internet is the way that it is, my personality kind of, and my history with this didn't kind of come out the way that, if you knew me in real life, you would know that this was totally cool, this is just the way Lynette's wired. So that took a little bit of getting through. We were featured in Mashable early on, and I got a whole lot of hate mail for that.
Oh, I'm sure.
It was
Women of Google Plus.
Women of Google Plus was featured in Mashable early on. My phone was burning up with text messages for that one, but
that's
I got a lot of slack.
Buzz.
For women, and you know, the surprising thing, it was generally women in their early 20s were giving me a hard time about it, which I found surprising. I'm 40, so it shocked me.
Interesting.
But I kind of just grinded through it, and it is what it is now.
I'm in the process right now of building, my friend Megan Monique is putting together an online community just for women, and it's called The Goddess Life, and it's a space where women can, you know, kind of like nurture their soul, like get support around things that they might need healing around, but really just a space to be vulnerable, to like put their fears and concerns and anything that they have inside of them out to a group of, you know, guides per se that kind of like nurture them in different ways. And I'm working as a creativity guide to help people like find the best parts of themselves through creativity. And it was really interesting to me that you brought this up, because we haven't met that yet, maybe because it's more of like the spiritual side of things and not so much the business side of things, mm-hmm. which, you know, is interesting how you can look at something through such a different lens, you know? So because it's business, it needs to be, like, equal and, like, politically correct. But if it's spiritual, you know, it's okay. So that was really interesting to me. So thank you for sharing on
that.
And
that's part of, I think, why I'm – and it's funny because I say we in the, I don't know, royal sense. It's me, the Women of Google Plus, that – every Monday I wanted to have these kind of professional talks. But the thing is, and I had someone last week email me back and say, well, how come we were talking about all this other stuff except for the topic that you're talking about? And I'm like, well, we were talking about the topic and all of this other stuff, not instead
that's
of.
That's what happens when women get together and talk.
But that's what happened. Well, last week I had a male guest, a guy on there. Yeah. But, you know, just as what happens in conversations and your life, it becomes all-encompassing. Like, even, like, I'm looking at, like, I have this whole big thing of show notes on the side kind of thing that I, in case I had, you know, things I had to fill or whatever I had to talk about for tonight. But the idea of businesses or goal settings or families or whatever for women, it all mashes up together. Where I think men can I'm thinking they can kind of compartmentalize a bit.
This
better.
Isn't a negative thing, but men when you put men together with women, they tend to posture a lot more. There's a different vibe that happens. We can talk business, but we can also say, I'm upset about this, or this is a struggle for me. You don't hear that kind of stuff. I know I've been in a lot of groups with men, and I don't hear them talk that way.
No.
So you have to be this other kind of person.
Yeah.
Anyway, it's uncomfortable for me sometimes as an older woman now versus when I was in my early 20s and kind of rocking the career path, that it was difficult to find, like you were saying, like that tribe, that like-minded tribe. Because I looked at them and they were my tribe, but they weren't like-minded. Like we had a lot of, you know, we had career goals the same, but how we anticipated meeting those goals was completely different.
Yeah.
Right.
They were like, you know, and one of the companies I worked for, which I should really do a whole video on because it's this most interesting thing. It was a very old school boys club type thing. And if you were not in the boys club, you were dirt.
Yeah.
Where, you know, they would literally go out and drink, was it brandy, I guess, and cigars is how they did
scotch.
It. That kind of thing. And I was like, I don't want to do that. So, you know, like, I didn't have a tribe, so I formed my own here, but the idea of bouncing around because our lives are so intertwined. And Megan right now is the queen of mashing. She's the mashup queen right now as far as I'm concerned because you got like three big things going
on. I mean, and
on.
I only talked about the big things. Like, I mean, it's like crazy. I was like, I had the day off. I'm like, I'm going to wash my clothes. I can't tell you how
young lady.
I can't tell you how responsible I felt because, and then my fiance's like, are you going to switch the clothes from the washer to the dryer? I'm like, oh, right, that's part of it. I haven't done this for so long, I've forgotten how this works.
The whole, like, when you were first saying all of this stuff that you were interested in kind of tackling this year, I'm like, how, part of me was like, how are you going to compartmentalize it? Like into this, you know, and I'm like, wait, no, we don't do that. How are you going to blend it together that you make sure everything gets addressed? And that, I think, is part of I don't want to say our problem, because I always, if I form an absolute with something to say all women or all men, then I always get shit shot at me. Like, it's just really bad. Some women, that's what I learned to say.
A lot of women.
A lot of women have a heart when we're dealing with all of these things at once, everything that gets neglected. Like, that was part of the thing that kind of was going through my mind as you were saying that is, like, you've got three very separate things that you're interested in, the majors. Like, how are you going to make sure that you put the time into all of those things and give it the love that it needs without wanting to go and cry in a laundry pile?
Well, I cry in a laundry pile often. One of the things I did do it recently was I set a schedule with my clients. So I said, I'm going to be on the clock for you 2 hours this day, 2 hours this day, and 1 hour this day. So in doing that, they know that anything that they need me to do for them, like online, social management-wise, is going to happen within that time frame. And if they need something immediately from me outside of that, then they have like three ways in touch with me, and then we kind of evaluate from there if it's something I can do. Now, if it's something simple like putting a post up on Facebook or, you know, really quick looking over a document for them, then, I mean, I usually work quickly. Like, that's one of my skills and my talents, is that I have found a way to get things done really swiftly and efficiently, so I can kind of squiggle it in there. Mm-hmm. So setting a schedule has been really important for me. So knowing that, you know, on a Wednesday, I'm going to take care of my blog, and then knowing that on a Thursday, I'm going to go to the gym, and then after I come home from the gym, I'm going to, you know, specifically look at emails. And a big part of it is keeping up on certain things. So it's like the maintenance of doing things very ritualistically, and communicating that to my fiancé, Todd, and getting that support from him. Like, he's a huge part of why I'm able to do the things that I do, because he keeps me in check, in a sense. You know, he's like, okay, well, you have these things going on, and, you know, but you know you have this deadline coming up. And so I really value that partnership. But it's a tango. It really is. Like, it's like, woo, here we go, Monday.
It also becomes an acquired skill when you're in the zone, as they say. Once you're running and it's happening, it is. It's not really as hard as it seems, as long as there's all this stuff happening. You set it. You're. It's like being in the zone. Do you know what I mean by that? Yeah.
And oh, totally. And a big part of it for me, too, is like taking the sabbatical. So knowing that, like, when I feel like I need to sign off or log off of the internet or just be away from Facebook or just be off the clock, I'm just going to be off the clock. Like, today, I sat on my couch all day long and watched the Food Network and looked at Good Food and fell in love with Paula Deen all over again. And you know what? At the end of the day, like, I'm sitting here on my computer doing work, and I said to Todd, I'm like, I feel great. I said, I'm going to go in my scrapbooking room. I want to make
a little mini vacation.
I mean, knowing what your limits are, like, knowing and listening to your body and being like, okay, I'm tired. I'm going to go to bed, and it's 7:30. And, you know, knowing that you can't do everything in a day, but over-communicating that to the people that it matters to. You know,
I'm learning that lately. That actually, if I'm tired, I can't do it anymore. I cannot stay up till 2:00 in the morning every night trying to get, because I don't really end up getting anything done. That's what happens.
I can't do it either.
I can't. I tried. I can't. I used to be able to do that. I can't do it anymore. I can't.
I went to a business class, like an intro. It was called Women Entrepreneurs, and it was like a business writing class, but she had so many people that got into the class and hated it that she had to do like a pilot program for the class. So you would pay like $25 to go and like do this like pre-class class. So we went in, and then, I know, it's kind of crazy.
That's why she's an entrepreneur.
So I, you know, I went with my friend, and we're sitting there, and the only thing I remember walking away with that was her with like this, like, just disdain in her eye, and she's like, if you want to be an entrepreneur, you'll stay up until 3:00 in the morning and wake up at 4 a.m. to do it again. And then so I tried to start doing this. I'm like, yeah, I'm an entrepreneur. I'm going to stay up late and wake up early, and it's going to be awesome, and I'm going to do what I love. And I was like, this sucks. I'm not doing this, you know? And then I realized you can't listen to what everybody tells you, you know?
Which goes back to what I said before. Sometimes you got to know where not to put it out to.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah, you can't. And that's the thing. If you can find your own rhythm, and actually that's one of the things that's so great about this social media, because you find like-minded peeps like you that are actually up at night, and you're like, wow, I'm not alone. There are other people doing this, you know, that are working at night. I'd rather sleep later in the day. That's the good thing about being an entrepreneur. You can do it if you want to.
If you don't have children.
That's the good thing about having your kids in college.
Exactly. I could, but you know what, Lynette? You're exactly right. I mean, I would say, I hate this. He had to be at the bus at 6:30 in the morning, you know, when she was in high school. I hated that. But by senior year, I'm like, I don't actually have to wake up. She can do it on her own. It was great, you know?
I have to admit that that's probably my least favorite part of being around other entrepreneurs, or being around like the startup scene or any of these types of situations, is that because nobody seems to go to work before 10 in the morning, and I'm a country girl at heart, like born and raised to like early morning chores. If my day is not started by like 5:30 or 6, I like life has ended for me. And I've been
go girl.
I crash. Like, find me at 10:30 at night. Like, I'm going to school or I'm going to bed with like children at 8:30. I really am.
In my heart, I want to be that person, and I really try to be that person. But I think my natural clock is not that way.
Yeah, I know that most people's is not. But mine is, and I find that I think that's probably the best part about it, is that because I'm such a rare bird that I get like so much done if I go to work between like 6:30 or 7, mm-hmm. that like 2 hours, 2.5 hours before like nobody is alive, you're like, yeah, I'm actually getting something done. But then this is the problem, like this is so past my bedtime. Stay up.
I know. I look at the clock. I'm like, wow, you're just gonna fall down. Like,
I am.
What do you do?
I'm a research analyst. I'm a consumer behavior specialist. So
do you go to an office, or do you have, or you work for yourself?
No, right now I'm still a cubicle rat. So, yep. So I'm still there. Yep.
That's my cubicle dance.
The rest in the house. And eventually things will change, but right now I'm still a rat in a cube. So
here's the future entrepreneur dance for you and me.
I hope so.
Are you an entrepreneur.
Are you still working a 9-to-5, Megan?
Oh yeah, I'm still working a 9-to-5. I'm working an 8:30 to 6:30, really.
Let's be real. I work for 6:30.
That's what was happening when I was working for somebody full-time. I would try that. I would try to get in early so I would get a good head start, feel like I really had a full day in, and I wouldn't feel guilty about leaving earlier, but I never left earlier. So
yeah,
the problem
see, 8:30 is our time to be in. That is our start day.
Yeah.
And we go till 5:30. It's just so loud all day long that my highest productivity is 8:30 to 9:30 and 5:30 to 6:30.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
The rest of the day I'm just like,
No, I believe it. And that's the point, is that I agree with you that I love getting up really early and getting this, it feels like you're up before the world, and it's everything is calm and quiet and you can focus.
Yeah.
But then at some point or another, I turn around and I'm like, oh my God, it's 12 o'clock in the afternoon. What the hell happened? You know? So I don't miss those things. I don't miss working someone else's office. I don't.
No, and the thing is that when you work late like that, like between 2 and 3 in the morning, I sometimes look back and it's total crap.
Yeah.
I agree. Really good.
That's,
you know?
That goes back.
What I think is good and then what perspective tells me are two totally different things. Because I have to do all my stuff after my kids go to bed, and then I have work a karmic job, I call it, you know, kind of job because your kids don't sign on to be starving artists, you know. So then, you know, from like, I have the window from like 9 to midnight, 9 to 1 when I collapse. But if I work past that, it comes out like completely garbled. And then when I'm trying to edit my online magazine at that point, it's like, really? I can't tell a semicolon from my, you know what?
Yeah, I think it goes back for me to Stacey's point, is that, you know, if I have a project going on, I've had meetings all day, it is literally goes back to what Stacey said. You have to know, like, your limits. Like, there is one. As much as you have to know where you're going, like, you have to know, like, this is officially the stop point.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Does anybody else have Google Plus, like, totally interfere with your work? at all. Like, I'm social. Completely addicted to this, and I'm like, okay, who can I talk to today? What's going on today? Let's see if we want a G plus today.
For me,
write a blog? No.
For me, it's social media in general, like bouncing between, like, being on Hootsuite, number one, and like just like trying to like monitor certain words. Or, like, I have a marketer's heart, like deep down inside of me. I think all entrepreneurs do. I am just like, oh my gosh, social media. I want more. I need more. And my boss will come over and be like, are you on Facebook? I'll be like, uh-huh. I don't know what to say.
I'm not even really on Facebook anymore. I'm total G plus fangirl at this point.
See, I kind of bounce between the two, but a lot of the people that I work in scrapbooking and memory keeping, and a lot of that demographic is like very much on Facebook.
Dang.
So I feel like
same with me with poetry,
Yeah,
you got to kind of speak. I feel like you got to keep talking where you know people are at. Mm-hmm. But I much prefer Google Plus in all facets of what it does, how it functions. Mm-hmm. I think it's beautiful. Like, I really do. I feel like it's like a hot guy that I'm kind of in love with. You know, I'm like, oh, you are so pretty. You are so cute.
Wow. Yeah, exactly. Well, you know what's funny is like I'm a poet, and that's one of my blogs is that I have a pretty decent following. Actually, mostly women. It's kind of funny. It's a lot of it's like sensuality and all that stuff. Yeah, and well, the most of the people are on Facebook. I mean, there's like a million poetry communities, and I'm an admin for like 15 different pages. But I tell you what, I don't know. There's just something about here that's different. And then, you know, that there's not a big poetry community here kind of lends itself to starting one, which is kind of cool as well.
Yeah, I feel like there's a lot of opportunity here, you know, and there's a lot of ground to be struck, you know, as far as like becoming that resource in this realm. Mm-hmm. For the thing that you represent most, that you are most passionate about. And I've tried to, I mean, there's a lot of scrapbookers on here, but it's more of the digitally savvy people, you know, like the people I feel like I'm more looking to talk to people that want to learn more as opposed to, you know, people that already know how to do it. So.
Okay.
Woo!
Yeah, I'm telling you, you're on fire, sister. What's up? Come on, whatever you're on. What are you taking?
I'm like sweating. That's what I do.
Entrepreneurial.
It's 125 degrees.
You have to get the next. You need to start a hangout for that. This entrepreneurial.
Gosh.
Working up a sweat, baby.
I love it.
I know. That's great.
We before you had the last couple ladies that came on. We were talking about what was it? Smarter? Yeah.
My old.
We were addressing our goals, you know, and how they fit into that. So I kind of jumped in. So I thought that would be a good idea maybe to go back with somebody else who's on to share their goals. I share that I'm looking to build up my podcasting business and basically get more clients, which, I don't know, Lynette thought that was a little too vague, but.
Oh, I have a vague
one. Graded? Are you serious?
Oh, shit. Sorry.
Sorry.
I have a really vague one, if you want to go vague.
Yeah. She'll call you on it.
Breathe.
Okay, I actually think she's probably heard this before, but that's okay. So it's probably not happening as fast timeline-wise when we look at smarter in terms of time-wise. But that was my goal has been to be location and schedule independent. I don't even necessarily need to work for myself. I don't even necessarily need to be an entrepreneurial. I just want to know that if I want to work at my mom's kitchen counter, you know, kitchen table for 3 days at Christmas, that I can do that.
Mm-hmm.
So is the company that you're at now, they're not, are they open to something like that? Have you approached them?
It's really funny, you asked that, Stacey, because they're very old school, corporate. I'm not productive. In fact, I commute. If I choose to commute on a train to my office, it's a 2.5 one-way commute. 2.5 hours one way.
Yeah.
And I approached my immediate director and said, hey, this is kind of getting a little out of hand. And he says, well, you know, unfortunately, we really just can't know that you're productive unless we know that you're at your desk.
Of course. Micromanagement. Gotta love that, right?
I was like, really?
Well, Well, did you ever pun in those statistics about how, you know, social media increases productivity and or, you know, there's a million of them out there.
So,
but, you know, that's the perfect opportunity. We were kind of talking about setting the goals. You could actually put together a plan for them and say, look, let's put together these goals. And by such and such a date, I will produce whatever the work you guys agree on. And if by this date I have not produced this, then you're right, it's not working. But can we give this a chance?
And that's right where I'm at, is that I breached it with him and I said, so, you know, this is what needs to happen. And he's like, well, I don't think. And I said, okay, you don't have to say yes now, because I'm going to come into your office next week and I'm going to ask you the same question.
You know what I like what she said? I'm sorry, I don't know.
Go.
Cover over names. You can
what I really liked is that, you know, instead of saying, can I, you're saying, this is what we'll do, and here's why. And here's a portfolio, and here's all the demographics, and here's the reasoning behind it. Right. You know, I mean, they can't argue with that.
But also a goal. Show them what, you know, agreed upon between all of you. So what do you want me to accomplish by such and such a time? You know, here's the timeline. So that you can see that there is measurable, like Lynette said, measurable goals.
Yeah.
You
know? Well, what's funny is that we're a team of, seven. We're hiring one. So a team of six. Two people work from their home. I'm in New York. They work from their home in a different state. And one works 3 days a week from her home. So we're all on equal levels, and I find it actually really – so I'm working on, like, the –
Have you introduced them to Google Plus, like, you know, the Hangouts?
You can watch me while I'm working. Here
there
I am.
You go. Put it down. There you go.
Yeah, but then you can just put it on a loop, right? And you can just
Jennifer, I'm wondering, because I had to be asked this question eventually. Do you – like, really, do you enjoy working there, as in, like, do you still want to work for them?
Oh, gladly take anything else if I could.
Be the hell out of there.
And I mean, that's the thing. You're on Google Plus.
Now you're gonna have to edit this a little bit, I think.
No, it's okay, Lynette. Really, it's okay, because I actually had another meeting with our department president this last week and said, you know, things are not exactly working. And so in the end of it, he wanted my advice. He had gotten a new iPad, and at the end of it, he had wanted my advice on what apps and how to use it, etc. And I had to be honest with him. I said, Instapaper's my, go-to. That's definitely one you have to have for whatever reasons. And I was but I don't think I can show it to you. And he's like, why? I was like, well, it's kind of full of some job search listings, actually. And he's like, well, based on the conversation we had for an hour and a half before you showed me this app, I kind of got that message. It's okay. I understand.
And the only reason I asked you that is because I think, I have this conversation every 6 months with my managers, which is I just feel so stuck. I just feel like I don't have anywhere to go. And I mean, knowing that it's out there, knowing it's out there in the open, it makes me feel so much better, because when I do have that meltdown of I'm not going anywhere every 6 months, it's okay. Oh, she just feels stuck. She'll recover tomorrow. It'll be okay. But then that also keeps me present with the fact that I want to keep working toward what I want to do, to the things that make me light up with energetic passion and fire.
Yeah, I'm the same way, Megan. It's just, I'm pretty honest. I go to work, I do exactly what you expect me to do. I do it better than most. And you can't fault me for, needing and wanting. And I'm pretty transparent about, if you don't keep me learning and engaged, and something will give eventually. Yeah. So I'll keep doing what you pay me to do, and I'm here, and I don't have a bad attitude about it, because I do love it. I do like what I do.
Right.
But...
It's
gonna happen.
Well, that's actually interesting that you said the way you just worded that. I've been thinking about this a lot. A lot of these jobs that are out there now, a lot of the employment situation, and I don't mean the bad economy. I'm talking about the way things have changed. So these employers hire people and they expect them to have this full loyalty, like we were back in the 1950s.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But they don't treat us with that same respect and loyalty with payment and all the other things. You can't. I mean, there is a lot of, change constant change. Mm-hmm. So I did this part-time stint real briefly. It was for a couple of months, and these guys were like, well, we know you're this interior designer. How do we know you're going to stay? It was admin first to real estate guys. I said, you don't, but the thing is, I'm looking for a home. I'm looking for someone who's willing to pay me a decent salary. You pay me a decent salary, I'm not going anywhere. You know, I'll do my job. It may not be my first choice of jobs, but that's not out there right now.
Yeah.
So, mm-hmm. you know, I'm not taking this job to leave in 5 minutes, but you could always feel like that was what hung in the air.
Yeah.
So I knew it wasn't going to be forever, and I was kind of hoping it would turn into full-time. But.
The thing I love about my full-time job is that everybody knows that I have a blog. Everybody knows that I'm passionate about social media. Everybody knows that I'm hustling it, that I'm staying up until, you know, whatever hour of the night. And that the people that really care about me, I have a lot of friends at my job. They all support me 110%. Like, I have my army of cheerleaders, I call them, like this group of women at work. They're like, go, 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 Megan. And they're like, what are you doing this weekend for your biz? You know, and it's that support that I love. And then I have flexibility. Like, I can go into my manager and say, listen, I have, like, a bunch of writing to do, or I have this meeting offsite that I need to go to. And they're like, okay, you know, whatever you got to do, because they know that I do put in the extra hours. So there's, you know, there's that.
That's what makes you happy.
Yeah, it's there, and there's that piece of, like, because I'm loyal to them in a sense, you know, in that sense of, like, I put in the work, or like Jennifer, like you said, like, they know that I do it better than anybody else that could be in there, that they kind of, like, help support and nurture me because they need me, you know, and I kind of realize that, and they respect that in turn. So that's the great part of my job, because I don't think I could find another job that would allow, like, nurture my entrepreneurial spirit in the way that they
it's
have.
It's always a surprise when I meet people that actually have that feeling, you know, when I go to apply for a job, because I am always looking for a part-time. I still need regular income coming in.
Mm-hmm.
And so I will, and not that I want to do it, but I'll do it. I'm not lazy and I'm not stupid. I get what I have to do. So I go keep looking for regular paycheck job. One day that won't happen, but right now that's just the case. So I'm always surprised when I meet somebody who said, yeah, we'll support these initiatives or these things you're doing, because if I'm happy, then I'm not running anywhere, you know, but it's not, I don't find it that often. It's always
I mean, I think it's very rare. I think it's very rare, and I know a lot of people who have been in the same positions that I'm in, or, you know, are currently in my position, and they have to keep their internet life, or, you know, there, a lot of them are internet entrepreneurs, or they have some facet of,
secret,
of
right?
social web. They have to keep that so separate, and their internet life is so separate from their day-to-day life and or their office life. And I have my boss go in and Google me. I sat there while he Googled me at his desk the other day, and I was like, look, there's my blog. There's the grant that I won. There's this, there's that. And he was like, wow, this is really cool.
Yeah.
And I don't know
but
anybody else.
That's a
else.
Reflection, by the way. That's a reflection of the person you're working for. So that's the environment.
Oh, absolutely. Okay.
Yeah.
Absolutely. I mean, and it's a small family-owned company. I mean, in radio, it's unheard of, you know? So it's definitely, you know, a culture thing.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it's cool. It's really cool. Yeah.
So that leads me to ask you guys a question real quick about positive feedback and positive reinforcement. I mean, we all know that that's extremely vital in your job, right? So when you're doing the entrepreneurial thing, do you count that, do you measure that by blog hits or income, or what? How do you guys measure that for those of you who have done it? Because I'm right on the cusp, I think, of doing that. My goal is to, by March, be just writing full-time and stop working my karmic job. Actually, an interesting story is that I won't name my employer because, just not gonna. They started this internal, like, Facebook for the company.
Mm-hmm.
And I started writing a blog for that because I'm a blogger. That's what I do. And it went viral. And I actually got a corporate interview. And I can tell you, honestly, now...
It went
what's that?
Inside the company?
Inside the company.
That's
It was, like, better than the CEO, and it's a Fortune 40 company. So, I mean, so everybody's reading this. I'm getting all this email. I've got all this attention. I've been blogging for years, so it kind of came natural. And so when I went on this interview, and, I mean, they flew me down, the whole nine. And in retrospect, I'm really kind of glad that I didn't get that job. And it would have been like a puppet almost in a way, because I mean, I look at where they're at now, and I've been following very closely, and thank God for those kind of things. I don't think I could do the corporate world. I don't. I'm too much of a
corporate world. Ate it.
Extrovert, loudmouth, bimbo kind of girl. Like, what are you talking to me like? I don't think you're talking to me like that.
As far as, like, your question about praise, like, when I first started, I started blogging 2 years ago, and my blog has since been, I relaunched my blog in November. I moved from Blogger to WordPress and totally rebranded everything. I got rid of my name. I got rid of my followers. I took everything and was just like, I'm starting over. Ha, 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 fun. And I have this rule of, like, when I restart something, I don't look at my Google Analytics. I don't look at my post comments. I don't measure anything. Right? It's horrible. I won't totally lie to you and say that I didn't look at it, but I don't internalize it, right? So I don't connect my traffic and my comments as a benchmark of my success, because what I believe is that my success as an entrepreneur lies in the belief that I have in myself. So and in my commitment to keep doing it every day, to wake up and do it, right? Like I never want to have shame for not doing something to make myself feel right about it, right? So, like, I don't want to wake up one day and be like, oh, I didn't do that right, or I'm not getting enough, because then I'm just cultivating that type of attitude about my work, right? Mm-hmm. Like, I want to feel, like, awesome about everything that I do, even if it's not perfect in somebody else's eyes, right?
Sure. I'm glad you brought that up, because I get obsessive over that stuff. I'll post something, and then I won't look.
Yeah.
I just
let it go. Like, I picked up, I don't know if you guys know about the Reverb 10 project that Gwen Bell did last year. Well, I picked up on it, and I've been sending out daily prompts for Reverb 11. Like, I've been making them up. I've had some people submit some to me that I've sent out, but I've never committed to something so intense for, like, daily active blogging and emailing. But I did it, and in the beginning, I was like, oh my God, people are unsubscribing. What? No, I'm a failure. And then I was like, I'm doing this for free, first of all, second of all. I'm doing it because I want to do it, because I loved the project so much that I wanted to continue to give people an outlet. And if they're not retweeting my tweets or, like, commenting on my blog posts, so what? Like, it isn't about so much about them. Like, I'm doing this for me more than I want to teach people the art of memory keeping, but I want to do it because I love to do it, right?
So it becomes an innate thing instead of an atta girl kind of thing. And I like that. I write because I'm a writer, and I'm that's who I am, and that's what I do. So, if you do what you love and you work your ass off at it, hopefully, fingers crossed, it's going to work out. It'll work out.
And yeah, but I still need external affirmation. I'm sorry.
I love you, Lynette. I love your...
Yeah, so that's what I'm saying, is where do you get that from, Lynette?
Well, that's the thing. It used to be, and I go through waves. It depends on what part of whatever I'm doing. Mm-hmm. Years ago when I started podcasting, or years before that when I started blogging, it was, the comments and things. I started blogging in 97.
Wow. You are old.
You were 12 when you started blogging? Oh, my God.
I was -4.
I was blogging from the womb.
Exactly.
Well,
there's Bluetooth in there. I used to get caught up, but then what I wound up doing was finding sort of that, I hate to use this term because a client uses it, well, lots of clients use it, but I guess the mastermind idea of, that trusted source. But I like what Megan said. What was it? Your tribe.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Your like-minded tribe.
Your like-minded tribe.
Love that.
Have you heard of the idea of, like, aspirational marketing? Like, I drive, what kind of car do I drive? I drive a minivan now, God forbid.
I
can't wait to drive a minivan.
Me too, sister.
Is it a Toyota?
It's called having babies.
I want a baby.
See, I drive a Sienna now, right? So I turned 40, and then I got a minivan. It's over. I put zombie stickers on the back. Does that count?
Yeah.
That makes it absolutely cooler. Absolutely.
But, like, things that I aspire, like, not, like, totally out of my reach, but, like the 1.5 levels above or wherever I want to be. Mm-hmm. So people that I'm friends with in that bracket, so to speak. Not money, but just, like, where I see myself going, like, where they're just a little further down the path.
Little mentors, maybe.
Yeah, sort of, like, but not knowingly. They don't really knowingly. They're just examples for me, I guess. Mm-hmm. It's not an active thing. But when those people come back and kind of give me feedback or make comment, like, that's the kind of thing that I thrive on, because I'm trying to go up that ladder where they're going, and they're like, oh, Lynette, that was awesome, I wish I would have thought of that myself, or something along those lines. Like, that's the stuff that I totally
do. That's huge. Right.
Because internal, it's all negative for me. Like, I'm, like, the worst. Like, I'm like, oh, my grammar sucks because I'm from Jersey, and
there's nothing wrong with Jersey.
But at least you don't have hillbilly sayings like I do.
What's my favorite one? Like the crow flies. That's my favorite one.
Three ways to skin a cat.
See, you probably see all that stuff.
I'll be moving towards Jersey girl, so you know what? You're gonna have to show me the lingo and all that.
We have our own.
You know what? Yeah, I like that. I was a mental health therapist and addiction specialist for 10 years before I got married, had babies, long drawn out, got divorced, story, blah blah blah. And we call that cognitive behavioral therapy. It's like, what evidence do I have to support this? Who's a reliable source? Who can I trust? So I really like that. Absolutely. And peer review. Yeah.
But it's
like when you plus one myself, I'm like, oh, Lynette, awesome. I'm serious. Anyway.
Right, I would just like to publicly proclaim right now that I am a complete dork. So do not hang on anything that I do.
Years.
But the idea of people that I've known for multiple industries.
I think what Amy's saying, though, is, like, I think that's a testament to the personal brand that you've built, right?
Oh,
because
yeah.
we're so unaware of, like, what our personal brand is represented in other people's minds, right? So, like, that mm-hmm. idea of, like, perception versus reality. Like, our mm-hmm. reality is based off of our perception. And, like, you know, Amy's reality is based off of her perception. And her perception, like, it's like, Rockstar Lynette just puts one in my post. Whoa! I would probably feel the same way. It was kind of like with this, my friend Megan, when I first started following her, I was like freakishly following her on like Twitter, reading all of her posts. And I'm like,
oh, you were the stalker? You were the stalker.
The thing about it is I didn't know I was stalking. I was just like enamored by all the great things she's saying. And now she's like one of my best friends.
Aww.
You know, and it's funny how like the internet lets people be the best representation of themselves in that moment, you know, and then you can like connect with people. And I just, personal brand has so much to do with all of it, right? Mm-hmm. So, like, putting your best foot forward. Whereas, like, if I get stopped in the hallway at work, I'm, like, looking all disheveled, and I'm like, oh, what? I have a brand, and it's supposed to be represented right now? No! Like, I'm not interested. So, yeah.
You know what I like? I like the transparency of people when they do that. When their brand is, you know, it peppered with a little bit of humility, just like when Lynette just blushed. That was absolutely adorable.
I have no makeup on. I'm two drinks into this hangout.
Is that wine? Because I was looking at it like...
Wait a minute.
Y'all have wine? I don't know what it is, honestly. I don't know what it is.
You're fine. Nobody told me.
Wait a minute. I was thinking it was cranberry juice, and I was like, wow, she's really health conscious.
All right. That says it.
Plus. Right. No, but I mean that's a good point. I don't think we're really cognizant of the impact that we do make on social media, especially in a G+ format. You know, I got another one of these are the A-listers by Dan Soder today. I'm like, an A-lister? What are you talking about? I'm not an A-lister. I'm just some dorky girl from Ohio. What do you mean? really? I mean, literally. Even though I blog all the time and I write all the time, and I'm, you know, I don't know. But it's still surprising.
You're just you, right? Yeah. You're a mom and you have kids. But you know what
happens online is your awareness of yourself ends at your own screen.
Mm.
You don't know what goes on. And it's so freaky to see. Years ago when I started podcasting, people would walk up to me. In fact, Megan will love this. I used to own a scrapbook store.
Okay, I'm done. Wow. I love scrapbooking.
I was holding out on that because I knew she'd freak out.
Sorry. I squeal when I get excited, and I usually pinch my hands together, but okay, I'm done.
But one of the shows that I did was on paper art, and there's a huge, long story about why I was in tech and why I did a scrapbook store, but I won't get into that tonight. But I had gone to a big show in scrapbooking paper art, and a couple of women just walked up to me and started, like, crying hysterically and screaming, and then they, like, were hugging me, and they knew all this stuff about me, and I'm like, this is like the stuff you see on TV.
Yeah.
Like, because they had listened to my show, and they had recognized me, and I didn't realize it, and that was the first moment that I realized that I'm not just talking and typing into some magic box on my computer, that there's really people on the other side, which is personally why I love Hangouts so much, but because you could see those people. It's not just typing. Because the text back and forth, there's still a bit of disconnect.
Mm-hmm.
But the idea that our reach and our influence, whatever positive, negative, neutral, goes farther than our screen is really a hard thing that I'm seeing a lot of people are dealing with in Google+. A lot of people with their businesses are dealing with. I used to and still do deal with a lot of small, what I would consider local businesses, like they only have like one location, or, you know, they deal with their community. They don't have businesses that that their clients are worldwide or national. Right. They deal with local clients. So to them, the internet is so foreign because it's like, mm-hmm. if I do something, you mean just the people in this city aren't going to know about it. Everybody's going to know about it. It's a very strange yeah. phenomenon. That's still, I've been on the internet for a million years, and it's
that's
still
what
such a strange
a lot of
thing,
people
like
Amy
said. Like, you just mm-hmm. don't realize
right.
it.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
I actually had somebody say that to me recently. You know, they're not that involved with online. They have a website for their business, but that's as far as they're willing to go. They don't do any social media because they don't really want that reach. They still don't get it, that you can actually say, you know, blah, 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 and someone in Czechoslovakia could pick it up and reply to you or respond or comment or whatever. And that freaks them out. They don't want that.
They were the ones that belly-to-belly kind of sales, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
The whole dealing face-to-face, and that's a lot of that's fear-based, too.
Yeah. It's a transformation in thinking. It's mm-hmm. taking your thinking, and we're still in it. We're still evolving in that. There's still mm-hmm. so many people that are not there. Where it's like we're dragging them along,
yeah.
you know?
Mm-hmm. The one of my other side projects is I'm putting together a speaking group called Motivator Sessions for kids in high school that teaches them personal branding. So how to represent themselves properly on the internet so that when they go to apply to college or they go to get their first job, they don't have this hideous trail of like disgustingness behind them, right? Of like
your
nasty
hands
things.
In their hands.
Right. Ooh. Nasty things they've said or, you know, bad pictures that have gotten, you know. So teaching them internet etiquette in a sense, but in a way that's like exciting to them, that like you can take your passion and translate it into a career, but start now, because this is something I wish somebody would have told me. Like, I was using LiveJournal, you know, when I was in high school, and I was blogging daily, but I wasn't talking about anything worthwhile. I was writing poems called I Bleed Turquoise, you know? It was like things that were like...
Now, people like that poetry stuff now. Come on.
I know, and I still do write a lot of it. I just don't post it up on the internet anymore, but I had no idea the power of my words at that mm-hmm. point in time, right? And I was still into, like, journaling and memory keeping and all this stuff, and I'm just thinking, wow, if only I had had... You know, if only I knew then what I know now, in a sense, I wouldn't have had to take down 3 different blogs with all this, like, you know, very negative posts about the world on it. I could have been, like, spreading wonderful positiveness. And so I don't know what my original thought was because I'm so hot.
we were kind of...
There's a way of framing things, though. There's an incredible framework where anything can be branded as in a way, you know?
But also you're obviously you're younger than I am. And I didn't grow up with this.
Mm-hmm.
You know, this, the way we think is even different now because of all of social media and mm-hmm. our smartphones and our ability to touch somebody all the way over in Czechoslovakia in 5 seconds. I mean, wars are happening, and we're finding out about all the horrific things that are happening because people are tweeting, you know, or they're Facebooking it. And when I was growing up, that shit took like forever to come across. You had to wait days for the newspaper, you know, and radio and TV. This was, you know, exciting that a news reporter got to go in there, and it, you know, was scary. I mean, it's still scary, but you know, it's nothing now. We're almost, I don't say take for granted, but we're jaded. We take it for granted. We do, because it's my kids were raised with this.
Right.
You know, they don't know anything different. I still kind of knee-jerk back to, wait, there has to be more weight to your words and your thoughts and what you're putting out there. There's got to be more responsibility attached.
And that's what I talked to, like, what my original thought was. Like, I talked to all of my clients about a lens. You know, like, what do you want to be seen as? Like, what do you want to represent? And every time you talk about something or every time you put something out there, like, you should put it through that filter and, you know, make sure it fits with what you want to say, like personal or professional. I mean, at the end of the day, that's how you have to think about it. And that's why, I mean, I'm not scared to put things up on the internet because I feel like anything that I put up or that I put out there is authentically me now, is within the scope of, like, my personal brand. And I say the same thing to my clients. It's like, you know, you can be nervous or you can be afraid, but if it's what you're about, then all you really are is, it's like sending a fax or it's like sending an email to somebody else. Like, you're just disseminating a certain amount of information. And I find
phrasing it in a way that makes those clients feel like warm and fuzzy about it, or relates it to something that they do on a daily basis. You know, I work with people that don't have smartphones, which blows my mind, but I'm like, what if you didn't have to call me to read your emails? What if you could get them on your phone? Wouldn't that be nice? They don't think so.
That's pretty fun.
I do technical teaching, and those people, Megan, were always my favorite class, is mm-hmm. because, I'll be honest, it was the easiest class for me to teach because they weren't too challenging. My favorite
they didn't class. Say, yeah, but what about this? Algorithm?
Right.
What?
Right, but I taught adult ed for a long time, and I taught a class specifically for a long time to World War II veterans.
Wow.
Yeah, and so, yeah, to teach them, and I'm in a new location now, so it's harder for me to start those classes than what I did before, which is also on the platter. But I have a question for you, Megan, about when you go into the schools. How old are these kids?
I haven't done it in a school yet. I have a pitch out to my alma mater, but I've done it. The only speaking engagement that I've done with this specific speech was actually to a group of college-aged kids with autism.
Okay.
So college, not high school.
Well, I want to do high school, but the only one I've done is college-aged. But I want to do juniors and seniors, so people that are thinking about making that leap to college or to their next career path. And it's a group of us, actually. So it's two people that are in college, one that graduated, one that didn't graduate college, and a person that went right from high school into a career path. So it's all these different perspectives of how we've used the internet in different ways.
I'm just curious if you think that that's early enough. And the reason I ask is because in my Facebook stream that I completely loathe, I have six...
you're fabulous.
Yeah. I have six nieces.
Yeah.
Six.
It's
they're atrocious. And they go from 21 to 10, all of them now on Facebook.
Yeah. And I'm seeing the same thing. And it's probably not early enough, but here's the thing. Is like, I feel like educators are apprehensive about me even calling and saying I want to talk to their students about personal branding, because I feel like what I'm getting is, if they had it their way, there would be no talk of the internet. There would be no cell phones in school. Like, there's so much cyberbullying and this and that they just want it removed. But the idea
is liability too.
Yeah.
The
idea is that it's not going away. So I feel like there's a little bit more flexibility in talking to students that are on the cusp of leaving.
Can I give you a
suggestion? Yeah, please.
So you might have to. There is a liability issue there. So you're better off going the backdoor method and going to clubs, churches. Don't hit the schools. It will filter into the schools if you build up your validity.
Girls and Boys Club of America, the YMCA, blah, blah, blah. Yeah.
I never thought of that.
There's no school that's going to say, yeah, come in and talk about this, because anything you say, they have to pay for it if somebody misuses it. Or
and they have to support it, and it's always cover your butt in school.
A lot of red tape there.
You're better off going in other ways. All the sports groups, hey, I'd like to give a talk to your team, whatever, whoever has, and you can research it with your community if they have their own pages, you can research it with, because I have this conversation with my kids all the time. They don't really care. They don't want to hear me. They're too old at this point. They don't really want to listen to me.
I guess that's my concern, is that I look at the different, I am not a mother, no intentions, because I have six nieces, pretty much cured it. But I look at the different ones, and I got the oldest on G+ so that she could understand, and she understood that it was kind of like the next stage of her social media, and that there was a difference between Facebook and how she behaved, and Google Plus and what it was for. And we went through that talk, and we kind of explained to her the difference that, you're not going to be 18 for the rest of your life.
Mm.
And there was a point where she did kind of understand it, but I can almost guarantee that if I talk to my 19-year-old about it, she's not getting that the repercussions in life will affect her. I think that that's a really odd age.
That's a very narcissistic age, so you're really, you just have to keep saying it, but don't expect it to sit. But you know what, it's not even just an age thing. So how many times an email, and it's a professional sounding email, you're writing it about something, you're not just talking to your girlfriend, and you're writing it, I don't know about you, but I sit back and I look at it and I read it out loud, I say, I don't think that's, if I was receiving that email, I would take, and I'm trying to put myself in the other person's shoes, I would take it something different. I know what I'm trying to say, but maybe it's coming off differently because email and social media, it's just, you know, we do it all so quickly that we forget that we need to filter ourselves and take that extra second or minute to read what you wrote, you know, and maybe there is a better way of saying it. So it goes beyond just stop posting pictures of, you know, yourself with a beer can in your hand and yeah, you know, saying curse words because you can say it on Facebook. So it's not just an age thing. It's actually taking your words and you're sort of about your personal branding. How does it make you look? And we're not talking phoniness here. We're just saying, how is the other person going to perceive you from that? How are you coming off? Yeah. Is this really how you want
to
come off?
That goes back to reliable sources, too, yeah, because some are, you know, perception is a funny thing, really.
Yeah. All right, well, ladies, this was amazing, but I have to bug off. So are you going to do this every Monday? Is that what you're saying, Lynette?
That'd be great.
Was that the intention? Did we lose Lynette?
I can't hear her.
Oh, boy.
Lynette.
She's waving.
Oh, I think she might log out and then
right,
come back
well,
in.
Oh, she's here.
Yeah. All right, well, she's here. She's on the chat. Okay, well, I'm leaving. I'll look for and see if you're going to post. You ladies are awesome.
It was a pleasure to meet you.
Yes, Stacy. Such a pleasure.
Thank you
so much.
We'll see you again in another chat, another hangout.
Totally.
Bye. Good night.
Bye.
Bye.
I have to say I'm probably as well. This 11 o'clock business is...
I don't even know how you're still awake. It's the wine. I saw you go get that wine. It's
oh, yeah, I got that wine. When I said she had wine, I was like, whoa, wait a minute. Nobody posted that memo. But I have to...
Well, speaking of that, you know, talking about drinking on the computers, this is all recorded, yeah.
I'm okay with that.
Yeah, I know, I'm kidding.
Perfectly okay with that.
I'm okay.
It's my day off.
Love it.
But, yeah, I have to say that I love Lynette's Hangouts. I even posted a comment that this is my favorite way to meet new Google Plus people. They're the best people in my stream. But, yeah, I'm only still awake because I've been on vacation for a couple of days. So,
awesome.
But, however, tomorrow morning starts a whole new round of nonsense. Megan, I'm dying to hear more. I know I came on so very, very late.
Oh, we'll
and
chat.
I apologize to all of you for that. But, Lynette, who has been workaholic MIA, Missy, New York City, soon, please, yes. I see a nod, okay. A very big nod, hopefully. And if I read right, Megan, you are also not too far. Philly?
I'm in Philly. Yeah, I'm right outside of Philly. And I'm actually making a trip up to New York to see a bunch of my friends from the web is that a dance? I love dancing.
I'm actually right in the middle of Megan and Jennifer. That's awesome.
Where is that?
I'm right outside of Trenton.
Trenton? Oh, my gosh. My cousin works there.
Ghetto Fabulous.
He works for, like, he works there. But this is just exciting. I love meeting people in general, but people that live close to me that I can visit.
Yeah. Megan, when are you in New York City?
January. I haven't picked the exact date yet because January just seems to be filling up so quickly.
Yes,
but I'm planning on taking a mega bus up for a weekend and, like, making my rounds with, like, lovely people I've met on the internet and then one of my close friends who's going to be in my wedding who I haven't seen for a really long time. So
make sure you videotape it for us people who don't live in between.
Wait, you said you're Ohio, right, though?
Yeah. And my boyfriend, he lives in Jersey, right outside of Philly, actually. So, yeah.
Well, anytime you need me to drop off some surprises, like flowers or something, you just call me up. I'll drop over there. I just got my driver's license.
I want to see Megan in, like, the courier, like the Valentine's heart suit. Where she goes over to sing Amy's boyfriend a telegram.
Oh, my gosh. I am a horrible singer. That would be awesome.
That would be the best.
All right, ladies. It was very nice to meet you all.
Likewise.
Good night.
When you pick a day, Miss Lynette, pointing at you, Miss Megan, when you pick a date,
yeah, I'll let you know.
But yes.